Ladies and gentlemen, we welcome you today. I call to order the meeting of the Shreveport City Council. Councilman Willie Bradford will lead the invocation, and Councilman Jeff Everson will lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance. Will you please stand?
Let's pray. This is God, we come, Lord, thanking you again for this day and for this opportunity to come before the citizens of this city as we transact the business of this city. We ask, Lord, your presence in this meeting, direct our hearts and direct our minds, and what we do here today will be pleasing in our sight. We pray, Lord, for the citizens, we pray for all the elected officials, all those that partake of the service of this city. Thank you for our guests, thank you for those that serve mankind. We pray that when we leave here, Lord, that we would be pleasing in the sight that we have done work that would be beneficial for all mankind. It's in thy name that we pray. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
Please join me in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
The chair now recognizes Deputy Clerk Beatrice Pierce Johnson for the purpose of calling the roll.
Mr. Bradford.
Present.
Mr. Everson.
Here.
Mr. Jenkins.
Present.
Mr. Corbin.
Present.
Mr. Fleury.
Present.
Ms. Lynch.
Here.
Mr.
Bowman. Here. Is there a motion to approve the minutes of the Administrative Council of Monday?
I move to approve those minutes.
Second. Motion by Councilman Jenkins, second by Councilman Bowman. Any discussion? Please vote. That's a motion passes 7-0. Awards recognition of the next on our island by the mayor. Mayor, we're going to ask you to go first if you'd like.
Thank you so much, Mr. Chairman and members of the council. Today we have some very special guests with us. I'd like to recognize them and present them with a proclamation. I'm going to ask Ms. Neva Jones and our foster grandparents at this time to come forward, and I'm going to come down and read the proclamation, and we'll present that to you. Mr. Chairman, if you will come down with me, and let's just together, and then I'll finish the other announcements.
Okay, members of the council, proclamation reads, whereas service to others is a hallmark of the American character and central to how we meet our challenges, and whereas AmeriCorps and Senior Corps participants address the most pressing challenges facing our cities and parishes, from educating students for the jobs of the 21st century and supporting veterans and military families to providing health services and helping communities recover from natural disasters. And whereas the Cattle Council on Aging Incorporated Foster Grandparent Volunteer Program, a vital part of the Shreveport-Bossier City, Louisiana area, since 1980, is a sponsoring agency for the Senior Corps program. And whereas more than 125 Senior Corps volunteers serve 26 volunteer sites in Cattle Bossier parishes, providing vital support by tutoring and mentoring with schools and community-based programs. Foster grandparent volunteers help children in Cattle and Bossier parishes to develop the academic and life skills that are critical to their development and future successes. And whereas foster grandparents began in 1965 and 800 volunteers nationwide. Today, nearly 35,000 volunteers help more than 300,000 children through our nationwide network of organizations of improving behavioral and education outcomes, including daycare centers, Head Start centers, kindergarten and elementary school readiness for students,
need and needs. And now, therefore, I, Alias Tyler, Mayor of Shreveport, Louisiana, do hereby proclaim April 4, 2017, as Kettle Council on Aging Incorporated, Foster Parent Program Day, as National Service Recognition Day. That is going to be in April. And I'm doing that in the city of Shreveport.
Encourage residents to recognize the positive impact of national service in our country, to thank those who serve, and to find ways to give back to their communities. In witness whereof, I have hereunto set my hand and cause the seal of the city of Shreveport to be affixed. And we're going to present this proclamation to Ms. Neva Jones, and then I'll ask her to have words, and if you all would like to make statements to her, then you will be able to do so at that time.
Congratulations. To our Mayor Tyler and to our City Council, it is an honor indeed to be here this afternoon, and thank you for giving us the opportunity. I would like to share a word on behalf of the Corporation for National Senior Service that have served throughout the United States for the last 55 years. I also would like to share with you about just a few minutes to recognize other mayors for the northwest part of the state, which I was in charge to make sure we got a letter of support from the area. And I would like this time to just kind of mention the city of Bojan mayor, the city council of Bojan, Caddo Parish commissioner, Caddo Parish sheriff, Steve Prater, the mayor of Benton, the mayor of Blanchett, as well as Greenwood, Hardin, Morningsport, Oil City, Plain Dealing, Rodessa, Belcher, and Vivian. Those are the areas that is covered by this particular area, and so they have given already a letter of support, and also they are sent in a resolution. And all of this information will be sent in a report on April the 4th, along with the picture, showing that you all have supported this program nationwide in my community. I thank you very much on behalf of the foster grandparents and Cattle Council and Agents. Thank you so much.
Members want to say something, if they're going to ease out, she said. If you all want to say something, and then I'll finish my announcements if it's okay.
Just want to thank these lovely, mostly women, but I see maybe we can recruit a few more gentlemen to help you lovely ladies out. But we sure appreciate what y'all are doing, and it's been a wonderful program for years now, and a great way to spend your time, and we're so thankful for it.
Councilwoman Lynch.
Yes, we want. I too want to thank you all. As I shared with a few of the ladies, I will be 54 Sunday, so I think I only have one more year, and I'll get me a red jacket. So I will be joining you all soon. But thank you all so much for your service.
Mayor?
Okay, thank you, sir. Mr. Chairman and members of the council, we want to ask you to look at your calendars, and if the calendars allow, I'd like to invite you to the Governor's Restore Louisiana Task Force meeting, which will be held here in Shreveport this week. As you know, I serve on the task force, and we have the pleasure of hosting the public meeting at 9:30 Friday morning, March 31st, here in the chambers at Government Plaza. The task force is designed to establish and recommend to state and local agencies both short and long-term priorities in developing plans for recovery and redevelopment, Having the meeting in our part of the state allows our governmental agencies and citizens an opportunity to share the needs and ongoing concerns since the floods that occurred in our area in 2016 and also in 2015. But we did send two council members a copy of the press release that went out from the state level today. I only did that before coming down. Also, Mr. Chairman and council members, I'm excited to inform the council that 2016 was a record year for the Shreveport Municipal Auditorium. 29 events in 2016 versus 10 in 2015. Polestar, a concert industry magazine, released their top venues for 2016, and the Shreveport Municipal Auditorium was listed among the top 200 venues in the world. The Shreveport Municipal Auditorium was ranked 144th among theater venues. The rankings are determined by tickets sold worldwide for concerts and shows during the year of 2016. Total economic impact for the year estimated approximately $6.8 million. And 2017 is gearing up to be another amazing year. And I want to thank those council members who were able to join us last week as we honored our dedicated men and women in the police and fire departments. We're so excited also to announce that our very own Barksdale Air Force Base was selected to receive the Air Force Installation Excellence Award, and probably Councilman Jenkins know about that award. There were seven different pieces of criteria that were used to determine the winner of this prestigious award out of all Air Force bases in the nation. As the winner, Barksdale will receive $700,000 to invest in quality of life improvements for Barksdale Airmen. And we want to say congratulations to all of Barksdale Air Force Base personnel and to the Barksdale community partners. I think the official announcement is coming later, but we were called at the last moment last Thursday, to come over for kind of a mini celebration that they held on the base. But I did want our publics to know that Barksdale is one of the top Air Force bases in the nation, and thus far they have received this particular award and recognition. Our Shreveport Fire Department will be hosting their second Fire Ops 101 this Saturday, April 1st, 2017, beginning at 8:30 a.m. at the Shreveport Fire Training Center, located at 6440 Greenwood Road. You're invited to join them and participate. I did say to Chief Warburton, I'm coming by to see them, but I will not be going into the fire. But you are invited to go by and participate if you so choose. The Great American Cleanup Day, celebrating volunteers who participated in helping to clean up our city, will be held on April 8th, 2017. That's a Saturday morning, beginning at 10:30 a.m. at the State Fairgrounds. You're all invited to this outstanding recognition. We'd like to invite you all also to a ribbon cutting on Saturday, April the 8th, 2017, at 11 a.m. So we'll be going between the two events for the BHP Billiton YMCA on Knight Street. This state-of-the-art facility will bring multiple state and national competitions to our city. Some of you may recall last year when they did the groundbreaking on this facility and BHP Billiton donated about $20 million to actually make that particular project happen. And so now they're ready to cut the ribbon. You're invited to come and celebrate. The last announcement, and then I'll talk about some upcoming events, is, and we'll send this press conference out tomorrow. Our city will hold its second community meeting on the Bike Path program, which is kind of a pilot program that we're trying to put in this year. And we're going to do that one more time over at Centenary College at 5:30 p.m. next Wednesday, April the 5th. And it's going to be in Centenary College's Whited Room off Wilkinson Street. And you're invited to come and take part in that discussion. We continue to serve our citizens with numerous events. The city has supported the Sunday fun day at the Hedges, Patty in the Plaza at Festival Plaza. The Shreveport Metropolitan Ballet present Tales of Beatrix Potter Ballet at Riverview. Oceana Spring Festival in the Asian Gardens was also held. Crawfish Party at Betty Virginia Park. Warriors Run at Veterans Park. And many, many other activities. Those are the announcements, Mr. Chairman, for today. I do have two appointees when we get to that part on the program that we've appointed to hold positions on two of our boards that you have not met. And I wanted to bring those up so you could have an opportunity to see them today.
Mayor, would you mind bringing them on up?
Yes, sir. Mr. Grant Knuckles, are you here today? Come on up, Grant. Mr. Knuckles, of course, has been appointed pending your confirmation to the Shreveport Airport Authority Board for a five-year term beginning today, March 28th. He replaces Mr. Lampton Enoch, who no longer resides in Shreveport. And, of course, Mr. Knuckles will tell you a little bit about what he does. He's a young man that's up and coming with a great business here in Shreveport. And I did vet him, and he talked a little bit about what his vision is and how he wants to become active in our community and help serve. So thank you so much, Grant, for coming today.
Thank you, Mary Tyler, very much. And I just look forward to working with everyone and know how important the airports are to our city, for our citizens, for our business people conducting business in our towns, for tourists as well. So I just, anything that I can do to help lend support in that direction to put Shreveport first, I'll certainly do that. I own a Twisted Root Burger Company here in Shreveport and one across the river in Bossier, as well as try to stay active in the community, serve on various boards, and some friends of mine conduct some events in town, one of which the mayor mentioned earlier, Crawfest at Betty Virginia Park was this Saturday. We had a great showing of community support there as well. So. I've had the pleasure of knowing some of you and look forward to working with the rest and excited for the days ahead in Shreveport.
Thank you, sir.
Any questions, council members?
I just make the comment of if his services can be anything like they did on the Crawfest, you know, we have got a great future ahead of us there. So tremendous love.
Thank you.
Very impressive.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you so much. And by the way, he does reside in Shreveport. Otherwise, I couldn't have put him on. Thank you. Thank you, Grant. Okay, the other one, Mr. Marshall Farrell, apparently appointed to the Zoning Boards of Appeals for a five-year term beginning today. He replaces Mr. Rick Holland. Of course, Mr. Farrell is the president owner of Construction Safety Products, where they supply tools, fasteners, erosion control materials, and the list goes on.
Yeah, that's right.
But we want to thank Marshall for taking on this opportunity to serve in our city. We're excited to have you.
Thank you, Mayor Tyler. Again, my name is Marshall Farrell, lifelong resident of Shreveport. I actually led a group of local investors in May of this past year to buy Construction Safety Products. We've been around for 30 plus years, multiple locations, a lot of moving parts, and we're kind of in the lifeblood of development as construction goes, whether it be road construction, commercial construction. So I told the mayor that I think this could be an exciting thing for me to help contribute my ideas and experiences as well. So looking forward to the opportunity, and I'm very appreciative for the nomination.
Any questions, council members?
Thank you very much. Glad to see two nominees who are even younger than me.
I know you were going to say they were both in District B, but I was of...
Yeah, no. I think while Grant spends a lot of time in District B, I think he's maybe a District D resident, I believe.
I don't know about Marshall.
All right. Those are the announcements, sir, for today, and those are the two new ones, and you've already met the other appointees, and we thank you.
Okay. Communication, council members. Councilor
Jenkins.
Just one thing I was going to say about Crawfest was fantastic. I don't know, Grant, did you ever, do you have an idea on the actual numbers that?
We think around 3,000 people throughout the day based on the amount of beverages and food that we sold, and just a wide swath. I saw a lot of new years in the room with every appreciate your support. Just a great cross-section of the community. Lots of families, lots of pets, lots of coolers. Everybody's paying, and it was a big support. That is fine. We take one of our finest public spaces in the park.
And I'll just, do you mind if I follow up on yours? I was going to say, I spoke to Matt, who was the organizer along with Grant of the event, and he also wanted us to share, and of course, Councilwoman Lynch, I had a great time seeing her there that day. I know there were a number of other elected officials there, but when I spoke to Matt, he mentioned that not only was this such a great event to, you know, get the community together and give them an opportunity to come out and celebrate beautiful weather and a great time of year, but also they're making a donation to the Neighborhood Association, over $1,000. To the South Islands Neighborhood Association, which is fantastic. And he did want me to mention just a few people at SPAR that he said, under Shelley's leadership, of course. He said Catherine, Monica, and Esther were just incredible to work with and wanted me to share their appreciation of that. And that Sergeant Van Zandt and the rest of the people from the police department. He actually said, they've done a lot of events in their time, and he said this was the most professional, set of police operations that he had seen in any of the events that they'd done, and he was just so impressed with the level of service. So we want to send a special recognition to everybody who was involved.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Certainly, we recognize we're in the festival season. And with the good weather, and there are no shortage of things for people to do in our city. And every now and then we have somebody come up and say, "We need this, we need this, there's nothing to do." Well, they're just living with their head in the ground because there are many opportunities for free things. I did want to mention that on March 17th, St. Patrick's Day, I had the opportunity to be down in the Red River Entertainment District. And it was very encouraging to see it packed down there under the bridge with a very diverse population of citizens taking part in that. I think part of that was private, part of it was city, so it's a little partnership thing there, but glad to see some new life in the entertainment district.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Jeff, you have something you want to follow up with?
Yes, thank you. I'm sorry. I did want to just mention a couple other events that, as the mayor mentioned, some great events, and she may have covered some of these, may not. There's so many good things going on. I just wanted to make sure we didn't forget. I wanted to thank the Highland Restoration Association. Is putting on a series called Restoration University, and they did their first installment of it. And basically, it's a series of lessons on the history of Shreveport, as well as architectural styles in Shreveport, and this time they focused on one of Shreveport's early developers and investors, Edward Jacobs, and it was really fascinating. And so, I want to thank them for doing that. And they held it, in the heart of Highland, so it was great. It was a well-attended event. Also, I know the mayor did mention this, but they just deserve multiple mentions, is the Asiana Foundation. They're just a wonderful citizen group that year after year continues to improve a public space, and they hold these events. If you haven't been, they are a group of Asian subcultures who come together as one group, and they rotate through their various countries, and every 6 months they put on a celebration of one of the different cultures that is a part of the group. This time it was a celebration of Vietnam. And it's just a real treat to see private citizens come together to make this space so active and engaged, but also to share a little bit about their communities with the community that they now call home. You know, it's such a inviting festival that reminds us of really how diverse our community is, and they do a great job of celebrating that. Didn't want to skip over that. And also, of course, this coming weekend we've got Cork and the Big Scene, which will be including the Makers Fair and some of those other events. Also, the unveiling of a bunch of new murals downtown. I don't know if anyone's kind of noticed those. Those are part of a project that was funded in part through the NEA, I believe, they're just great looking, and we just want to thank all the people involved in and the Shreveport Regional Arts Council and Shreveport Common and all of those great cultural events that are going on, that'll be going on throughout the next month.
Okay, that's it. I want to recognize Dr. Boris, if he can come up to the front, please. Had two important things
he
wanted to discuss with us today.
So. Okay, good afternoon. I'm Doc Voorhees, and as you know, March is Social Work Month, and this is Loretta Levitt. She's president of the National Association of Social Workers for this area, and we had several honorees that we honored during the banquet, and of course the mayor was one of them, and we'd like to officially present her award, and I'll let Loretta present it.
Each year, our chapter selects Public Official of the Year, and a few of you have been recipient of our NASW, like Council Oliver Jenkins, our late Joyce Bowman, and hopefully there will be some more. This year, our Public Official of the Year is presented to our Honorable Ollie S. Tyler, our Mayor of Shreveport.
Just say a word about the mayor, who is such a worthy recipient. When I came to Shreveport in 1995, she was one of the first persons that I met, and she was assistant superintendent of schools at the time. And of course, we got here too late for my son to get into the magnet program, and he was in the magnet where we came from. And so I was determined to get him in. And she took an hour when I went to see the superintendent that she didn't have because she was en route to another meeting, to help me understand that my son could get a good education in the system without going through the magnet program. And I thank you for taking that hour that you didn't have, and that's why she's such a worthy recipient of the award. And I'm sure she did that for many, many other people. And the other thing, did you want me to go ahead and mention Paint Your Heart Out? And I thank you for the opportunity to serve as co-chair for Paint Your Heart Out. This is the 25th anniversary year. As you know, it's been very, very successful. We got over 1,000 volunteers one more time. And, of course, it's under the direction of Ms. Bonnie Moore. And we're just excited about the program. And David Aubrey is the chairperson. The deadline has passed for applications. But, you know, as councilman, we want to make sure that you have an opportunity. If there's anyone in your area that, we can paint your house, someone in your district, we just love to. We got 1,000 volunteers, so we got enough volunteers to take care of whatever you could refer to us. And I think it's a fantastic program. And thank you so much.
You're going to get some phone calls from a few people up here now.
Oh, okay. Well, won't you send those phone calls to Ms. Bonnie Moore's office? Thank you.
Oh, doctor.
Doctor.
Charles,
Bonnie.
Charles, Bonnie. What
is the date, by the way? Just so.
Let's see, Paint Your Heart Out is May 16th.
Thank you.
May 16th.
Thank you, sir.
Oh, yeah. Thank you. The tragedy is you have all these volunteers and people that need their houses painted, but for some reason it's hard to connect. And they have aggressively marketed with different associations, organizations, and so we just love to paint a few more houses.
Thank you. I've often been curious, and I don't know if this gets done or not, or if it's even information that's available to us, but I wonder is there a way that we can cross-reference the ownership from the Caddo Parish Assessor's Office, where we can identify those homeowners who are over 62? I mean, they have a property tax assessment freeze at some age. You know, we may be able to get a map or a database of people that we can approach directly, because, you know, I know part of the challenge here is finding people who are homeowners over 62 years old
and of moderate to low income, you know, and so it's not always easy to find those three overlapping. So if there was a way where we could at least start out from knowing at least where all the homeowners that are that age are, that might give us an ability to get to find the recruits more easily.
Well, you know, we're open to, you know, we work aggressively with the ministers, the associate, you know, and Brother Graffin can tell you, we aggressively work with
them. Oh, y'all do a wonderful job. I was just wondering if that information could be available, that might be helpful.
Fantastic.
Yeah, well, I'll see if I
can explore that.
Dig around and see. Maybe we can find out.
And give that information to Ms. Moore also. Yeah.
Absolutely. Well, thank you so much, Doug. She was watching. She was listening. She was paying attention.
Also, see Mr. Tubman, he's library. I don't know if he had something he wanted to come up and say or anything. I just wanted to recognize you, Mr. Tubman. Everybody see
you. Mr. Tubman, we just wanted to recognize you.
I'm sorry, gentlemen. My hearing aids really aren't that great.
But that's okay. We get through this. We wanted to recognize you, and just since you were here at the council, I know you had some town hall meetings.
Yes, sir.
And you probably want to speak about that.
Okay. We are in the middle of doing what is required by the state library. It's a strategic planning. I'm sure the city has gone through something like that. On occasion, we are having some town hall meetings. We've had three here recently. We will have five more. If you'd like to participate, I do believe we've invited many of you to join us. We'd love to have you out. We are basically asking the citizens of the parish and, of course, Shreveport, what they want from their public library system. And there are lots of different services that we offer. We'd like to prioritize exactly where to allocate our resources properly. At this point, it looks like early literacy is number one in the hearts of all of our citizens. And, of course, that makes me nice and warm and fuzzy inside, because early literacy is something I'm very happy to support. And, of course, a lot of our staffs are behind that. So if you get an opportunity at the next five town hall meetings we'll be doing, please come out and join us. And also, thank you. Today, you'll be confirming the appointment of one of my Board of Control members, Julia Gehagen, and we really do appreciate you putting such a wonderful person back on our board. So thank you, guys.
Thank you. And lastly, I saw a good friend of mine, Derek, got in the audience. I don't know if I was stepping on somebody's toes or anything, but I just wanted to speak and recognize my friend Derek.
Derek and Nature, you guys come up for a second. They are the owners of co-owners of a new business. It's they want to bring it to Shreveport in some phase, but right now it's launched in other parts of the United States. They was here 3 weeks ago, actually, to introduce and put their product in. A couple of the local stores. The name of the product is banana milk.
Banana wave.
I'm sorry, banana wave. But it's Nature. You and Derek, introduce yourselves and just tell us a little about the product, okay?
Well, Shreveport, thank you for having us, and I appreciate being here. It's a beautiful city. I'm enjoying it. Derek is a great host. Derek, he's a Shreveport native, so you take it.
Yeah, we'd just like to officially introduce the product to Shreveport Bossier. We had an official.
Had two officials.
Two officials to come out at a county market about two weekends ago and support us with the grand opening of this product at county market.
I drank all mine.
You drank all mine? Great.
So, my name is Nature Akibaline, and I'm the founder and creator of Banana Wave Banana Milk. It's based on my grandmother's recipe, and this gentleman, Derek, here was one of my very first believers in the project and the idea, and he helped me get started when I was in college, and me and my fiance were sleeping in our car down in South Florida, so he was a very big supporter. But we're starting to expand. We have had some success, a lot of success, actually, and we're introducing the product to the Louisiana market. We launched it in County Market, and Derek mentioned to me, he was like, hey, well, you know, we're expanding. Why don't we consider, you know, bringing the corporate headquarters here to Louisiana and help you, you know, see how we can add value into you guys becoming an economic powerhouse, you know, here in the U.S. So I was open to that, and I came, I met Mr. James and Mr. Willie, and also I met the mayor for the first time yesterday, Ms. Tyler.
How beautiful people yesterday, yeah. How beautiful team.
We sat down and talked to them yesterday. Yeah. And we're very interested in bringing their headquarters to Shreveport.
Yes. So I told her, y'all going to have to, it's hard to get me out of Miami, y'all, but we're going to see.
But we're trying.
But certainly we appreciate even the notion and consideration of bringing that venue to Shreveport. We'll welcome it. I know if you spoke with the mayor, then I know she expressed her full support of whatever we can do to assist in that transition. We can also, you know, move to look at some options that they have as it relates to warehousing distribution areas, and as it relates to, I see you got a new container.
A smaller container. We wanted to create something that was small and compact that maybe we could put into the school system at some point or another, because the bigger package wasn't lunchbox friendly. So we had to think about who our core consumers was, which were moms with children.
So. And we will assist you, and if you haven't already, create a relationship with the superintendent. Schools, and maybe he can look at how that maybe could be a part of that lunch equation. So anyway, we welcome you. I want you to come back and share again with that product, James and I. We drunk our container, so we.
It's time to re-up now.
It's time to re-up. Uh-huh. We don't do that. But thank you, Nature.
Thank you.
Next time y'all go out and drink it, invite me.
So if anyone would like to try Banana Wave, we will hang around until the end of the meeting, and we have samples for everyone here. And thank you again, Shreveport.
Thank you. Thank you for coming over.
Thank you so much. Good to see you again.
Councilwoman Lynch?
Yes. I have a couple of things. One, I want to just talk about the awesome community cleanup that was in my district this past Saturday at Sunset Acres that was sponsored by Boys to Young Men. I certainly want to thank Mr. Chris Henry and the team that he assembled, the elected officials that came out. Councilman Bowman was there, Commissioner Watts, Gage Watts, Commissioner Chavez, and school board member Raymond Green. There were 90 volunteers. I think we ended up with about 100 bags of trash. And so it was very successful. I understand they're gonna do Queensboro next and continue to work with neighborhood associations as well as under the mayor's initiative to help clean up our city. And so I wanna thank them for that. Secondly, I was able to attend the crawfish, and it was a successful event. I knew it was all right when I was walking up and they were playing Sly and the Family Stone. So I was like, okay, this is going to be good. And I had company from out of town, so it was just nice to be able to have something. The weather was beautiful and something that was really representative of our city to take my company to. So thanks. The sponsors and everybody that was involved with that. Thirdly, a couple of weeks ago, we did a resolution, this body passed a resolution for National Women's History Month, and I did not want the month of March to end, without recognizing the monumental contributions that women have had in our city, and certainly with the city of Shreveport. And so I wanted to recognize some of those ladies today, and I'm just going to call their names, and some of them are no longer here and have retired and moved on and that type thing, but we do want to at least recognize them on today, okay? Y'all bear with me here. I've got Miss Tobacia Shepherd, was the first female MS2, which I'm not sure what MS is, okay? Does anybody know what that is, MS? I don't know what department that is, okay? Rebecca Blackwell was the first female meter reader. Tanya Smith was the first female operator. Josephine Lawson was the first female lab manager and the first female superintendent at the Lucas Water Plant. Bridget Franklin was the first female crew leader of buildings. Nancy Clark was the first female chief administration manager in water and sewer. Mary Williams was the first female chief supervisor of operations. Gyla Whitlow, G-Y-L-A, was the first female division manager with Sparsh Special Facilities. Autumn Permenter was the first female assistant city engineer. Stacy Kuba was the first female manager of the downtown airport. Quiana Lars was the first female superintendent at the Amos plant. Sonia Hall was the first female EMS officer. Deborah Mills and Gloria Wilson were the first female EMS supervisors. Kathy Rushworth was the first female chief of communication. Patsy Cross was the first female communication officer and the first female assistant chief of communication. Katina Seamster was the first female assistant chief of training. Joanne Hedgecock was the first female training officer. Patricia Dias was the first female fire inspector, first female assistant chief of fire, and the first female chief of fire prevention. Carolyn Henderson was the first female battalion chief. Deborah Mims was the first female firefighter, first female engineer, and first female captain. Robin Boyd was the first female crew member of Public Works, the first female crew leader in Public Works, as well as the first female driver operator of heavy equipment in Public Works. Dorothy Fornell was the first female property standards director. Barbara Featherston was the first female water and sewer director, as well as the first female assistant city engineer. Shelley Rago was the first female SPA director. Evelyn Miller was the first female risk management division manager. Lennis Graham Stewart is the first female city internal auditor. Angelita Jackson is the first female human resource director. Elizabeth Washington was the first female finance director. Terry Anderson Scott, the first female city attorney. Gay Gaskins, the first female city court judge. Maxine Prescott Sarpy, the first female councilwoman. Judy Durham was the first female CAO. Hazel Beard was the first female mayor. Ollie Tyler, first African-American female mayor. And of course, she has other recognition outside of the city. And of course, yours truly, Stephanie Lynch, the first female representative for District F on the Shreveport City Council. Thank you. We want to thank, you know, all of those women for creating opportunities, not only for, you know, other women, but just contributing to the life of our city and opening doors for those that have come, you know, behind them. Thank you.
Councilman Jenkins.
So, just like to talk about one of the fine departments in our city. We complain a little bit historically, and I'm probably one that's done it, about garbage pickup. So
For those that don't believe the system works, I have news for you. The system actually works. Put in there bulk pickup. I said, I am available for bulk pickup on any of these days. Gave a list of days. I got an email back that said, bulk pickup will be at such and such day. So the night before, I moved my stuff to the curb. The next morning, by 9 o'clock in the morning, it was gone. And if that is how the system is supposed to work. Nobody on my street had to look at my stuff for 3 weeks while I didn't put it out there and then call for bulk pickup. I used the system as it's designed, report a concern, put it in there, and it worked very, very well. So I commend Mike Wood and the rest of Public Works and whoever was involved in that system, because that is how the system is supposed to work, and I can tell you firsthand it worked perfect. So.
Thank you.
I had one more. Okay. I thought Councilwoman Lynch was mentioning that when she was on the women, but the AKA conference that was here in the city the week this past week, they took over the city, and I just wanted to say that. There was a lot of city women in town, and it was a real nice weekend. I think they bought some revenue to the city, and I appreciate that. If we can get the numbers to, we know how many is that going?
I think it's over 4,000, but I will get that from Ms. Tara Bradford, and if I may just mention, she was the first woman from Shreveport to be the South Regional Director for the Alpha Kappa Alpha Incorporated nationwide. So I wanted to congratulate her also. And I knew we would miss a bunch of people, so that's why I kind of made it a draft. Angelita worked on it diligently, I want you to know, but we still have so many more women, you know, that were first, like, you know, Virginia Sheehy was the first woman state senator in Louisiana, and on and on and on. So there are a lot of first women here, but she would be able to give us, I don't know, do you have an approximate number? And the economic impact was phenomenal. I'll tell you, those women came in with their families, and so we had a great time.
Madam Mayor, Mr. Chairman, Council members, the number was still approximately 4,000. We're waiting on the actual count. We had 4,000 to register through our sorority, but as you all know, in any conference, you always have other people who come in. Economic impact, we're waiting for the Tourist Bureau, but I know the Hilton, Shreveport and the other 20 hotels were very pleased with what was dropped in. So I'm sure, Madam Mayor and council members, when you see what those ladies did for our city, you'd be very pleased. And they did shop in our malls. I heard from a few of my friends saying that they were tired of seeing the pink and green in the Dillard store and on Lyon Avenue. But I told them they could get tired. That was economic impact for Shreveport.
Thank you. Appreciate it.
Okay, that's it. Any other comments from the move on.
I believe you took care of all the proper standards yesterday. Mr. Sweeney, you're not going to give us that case. Public hearing, there's no public hearing today. Let's move on to adding items to the agenda.
Mr. Chairman, there are two items that can be added. Resolution 65, this suspends the effects of certain sections of Chapter 10 of the Code relative to alcoholic beverages at the Holiday and Dixie Parade. And Resolution 66, which recognizes the benefits of national and local citizen service and especially the positive contributions of the Foster Grandparent Volunteer Program and the Caddo Council on Aging. And also, there's a possible confirmation of Mr. Joseph, but you might want to take the resolutions first.
All right, I'm sorry, I didn't hear that. We'll take the resolution first. Anybody in the audience that objects to adding the legislation? Is anyone here like to speak in favor?
This is on the resolution.
On the resolution. Okay, seeing none, then we'll...
I move that we will add these to the agenda.
Okay, is that a move by Council Bradford? Second. Bowman, any discussion? Please vote. And that passes 7-0.
Mr. Chairman, yesterday there was some discussion about adding to the agenda the confirmation of Mr. Curtis R. Joseph to the Metropolitan Planning Commission, and that would be the time to take it up.
I move to suspend Section 10 of the City's Council Rules of Procedure concerning the confirmation of appointments. Do I have a second? Councilman Bowman, second. Any discussion? Please vote.
Councilwoman Lynch has something to speak on. Okay.
I was just going to say I would like to take this up in our next meeting. And I know it was National Women's History Month, but I did an interview a couple of weeks ago, and one of the questions was, what are the advantages of being a woman in public office? And the other was, what is a disadvantage for being a female in public office? And I've been thinking maybe October will have been elected 14 years. And one of the disadvantage, and they're not many, but the disadvantage that I talked about was not being taken as seriously as your male counterparts are taken. As I would say, is probably the prime disadvantage that I found over these 14 years. I expressed, what my concerns were, which were addressed. And I was okay with that. But just the consideration and being taken seriously is something that is important to me. And when people choose, for whatever reason, to ignore that or to act like, I don't want to say it's a woman's opinion, it's not important. Doesn't matter, but certainly, I have to question, at times, if I'm being taken as seriously, and my concerns are being taken as seriously, by you all. It's a tough position, and I know this body has not had many women on it. When I was elected to the commission, it was the first time in 165 years of the police jury and the commission that there were 4 women out of 12 on that body. That was myself, Commissioner Bowman, Commissioner McCullough, and Commissioner Baker at that time. Out of all those seats, my seat, former District 7, is the only one that's still occupied by a woman, which I think is important. This particular body, has kind of, I think, gone between one to two. And so I would just like this appointment that I am going to support to be taken up at our next regular meeting. Thank you.
Any other people want to speak?
As I had expressed before it was offered today, because the vote has to be unanimous. I had expressed that, but if you're going to just go on and do it, knowing that I was not going to be in support of it because I had asked that we, do it in a couple of weeks.
Lynch, I have the greatest respect for you, but what if you made a mistake on this? What if you're wrong? The business of the
votes.
Okay, let me speak, please. I gave you opportunity. The people at MPC, the taxpayers, deserve to have a person up there representing in the next few meetings, because of the importance of where they're going for the future on business conducted up there. That's all I'm saying is this is the man that we've already vetted, the mayor's vetted. I'm just saying, why would you want to hold the people's choice up to conduct their business as a board member of the MPC?
The current appointee continues to serve until a new member is appointed. So there is representation there.
Okay? I agree with you.
So there's full representation.
Mr. Chairman.
It's just not this particular person in that spot.
Well,
there's representation.
I understand.
I don't want people to think
but
nobody
we can
is
disagree
there.
Agree to disagree.
Well, no, I was just saying.
I have no disrespect. I heard what you said.
I want people to be misled that there's no one there. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah,
there is someone there.
But we can concur, agree that the how accurate or how effective that number has been. Now, that's my point.
Mr. Chairman,
yes.
Point of order.
Yes.
The votes have been cast, and the anonymous decision was not afforded. So I call for the order today.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Just for the record, on this particular motion, a two-thirds vote is required. On the next motion that you would make to actually add it to the agenda, it would require a unanimous vote.
And I will, based on what Councilwoman Lynch has said, I withdraw my motion. Next on the item, Mr. Chairman.
Mr. Chairman, there we are now under confirmation of appointments. And there are several on the agenda. Would you like for me to read all of them, Mr. Chairman?
The names?
Yes.
Does any council member wish for the names to be read?
No, I think we visit with
I'm happy to move on all of them.
Let's move on all of them. All right. Motion? Councilman Jenkins, second by Councilman Bowman. Any discussion? Yes.
Briefly as discussion, I would like to thank, as we consider these, you know, there were two appointments on the Zoning Board of Appeal that are replacing people who were actively serving there, one of whom served for 17 years and another who's been serving for 27 years. So I want to acknowledge those people who gave so many years of service to that board, both Rick Holland, who served for 17 years, and Ms. Betty Osborne, who, as we're talking about, you know, females who've made a great contribution, Betty Osborne has served on that board for 27 years, and she's a senior vice president of the largest real estate company in town, and, you know, has done a tremendous amount of work there. So really want to thank them for their service, and thought it was appropriate time to mention that.
Yeah, just Mr. Chairman, and I appreciate you saying that because I was a privy to who was being replaced.
Neither were they.
Well,
but well, they have been spoken to now.
Yeah, but I'm just saying I understand that they serve at the pleasure of the mayor, so.
Sure.
But Mayor, do you ever feel to relate to us who's been replaced, or is that something that you
wish? No, I mean, normally we do. And, you know, I don't know if these were not, if you were not told who these were replacing, but these had been up for a long time. And generally I send a letter to every one of these. We have letters prepared to send those of appreciation for their service. And if there was a breakdown, we've had a lot of illness in the office. So I myself don't always get a chance to call everybody. But we do have letters prepared. I talked with Ms. Bracket this morning. She works on that for me. I can call her up and she can comment. But generally, we send a letter to all of these people first. And I just want that to be known publicly. I don't normally operate that way, but we've had, you know, Ms. Bradford's mother has been seriously ill in ICU, and we did not get a chance to get some of this stuff out. And so, but we do have letters so that people will not think that we're insensitive. All of the replacements we've done up until this year, we have sent letters to thank those people. So I want the public to know that. And I, too, want to thank these people publicly, but I do have a letter prepared. But here again, we've had a lot of illnesses, and I can't do it all. I do have people to do that, but they do have families, too. So we are appreciative to each of these people. What we've noticed about the Zoning Board of Appeals, and I think Councilwoman Lynch mentioned it to me maybe last year, a lot of these folks have been there 20-some years and have never been replaced and all of that, and their terms have, you know, come up over and over again. I'm just trying to make sure that we give everybody an opportunity to serve, and we do appreciate those who have served, and I'll get those letters out. But and that's what we normally do, and I can show you a copy. In the future, we'll always put in there who we're replacing, you know, whenever we do that. I didn't think there was a need to do that, but we can do that in the future if that's what the council would like to see before confirmations.
Thank you, Mayor, for that explanation. But the only reason I brought that up was that I did get a couple of emails from some individuals on not on some other boards that that said they was they didn't know, say, well, am I being replaced or not? But I told them again that the boards and commissions, they those members serve at the pleasure of the mayor. Once their time continue to expire, you have that right to appoint who you suggest. But I just I guess somehow need to be communicated who's been replaced before they because they, and, they
and
was wondering.
And we've always tried to do that. And I think what I've And I don't really know that much about city government, but I've always tried to do that. This time we had some extraordinary circumstances. I can even show you the letters where we've sent out to people. We just didn't this time because of all the illness we had with our staff. But certainly we're going to take care of that. You know, here again, going back to Councilwoman Lynch's comments, when the male mayors were in the office and they didn't do all of this, I didn't hear much about it. But we'll take care of the business.
I think Councilwoman Lynch was trying to get on the screen.
Yeah, I was. I wanted to recognize the president of the Shreveport Library Board that's here today, Josephine Babers-Wade. And one of the reappointments that the mayor is doing is Ms. Julie Gahagan. She's here as well. Thank you.
All right. We need, there are no public comments, Mr. Thompson. We're going to go ahead and vote on the appointments. If we don't vote on them as a whole.
That was a motion.
Motion. Okay. All in favor, please vote. And that passes 7. Next on item.
It's chapter 9, the consent agenda legislation. If there are no objections, I'll read the items that are on the consent agenda for introduction, and after they are read, a motion to adopt the consent agenda would be in order. Resolution 60 authorizes use of certain equipment by the North Shreveport Business Association. Resolution 61 authorizes use of certain equipment by the Shreveport-Bossier Sports Commission. Resolution 62 authorizes use of certain equipment by the Department of the Air Force Barksdale Air Force Base. Resolution 63 authorizes the use of certain equipment by Sports Spectrum Race Management and the River Cities Triathlon. Resolution 64 authorizes the use of certain equipment by the North Shreveport Business Association.
So moved
to
introduce.
Second. Motion by Councilwoman Lynch, second by Councilman Coleman. Any discussion? Please vote.
I'm sorry.
And then are introduced, both resolutions are introduced by 7-0.
Mr. Chairman, there are several resolutions on the agenda, on the consent agenda for adoption. Resolution 49 authorizes the use of certain equipment by the March of Dimes for the March for Babies. Resolution 50 authorizes the use of certain equipment by Shreveport Green for the Great American Cleanup. Resolution 53 accepts dedication of Lucian Way, Gulfstream Lane, Piper Drive, and Beechcraft Way right-of-way in Lucian Fields Estate Phase 1, Unit 8. Resolution 54 suspends the effect of certain provisions of Chapter 10-190 and 10-192 and Section 62-65A relative to the Southern Hills Homeowners Association's Music in the Park concert held at Southern Hills Park on Saturday, April 29, 2017. Resolution 55 suspends the effect of certain provisions of Chapter 10 relative to alcoholic beverages and Chapter 106 relative to zoning for property located at St. Vincent Mall for the annual firecracker run on July the 4th, 2017. Resolution 56 suspends the effect of certain provisions of Chapter 10 relative to alcoholic beverages and Chapter 106 relative to zoning for property located on Stoner Boat Lodge for the annual turkey trot on November the 23rd, 2017. And there were two items that were added, Mr. Chairman. Resolution 65 suspends the effect of certain sections of Chapter 10 of the Code relative to alcoholic beverages at the Holiday and Dixie Parade. And Resolution 66 recognizes the benefits of national and local citizen service, and especially the positive contributions of the foster grandparent volunteer program and the Caddo Council on Aging and otherwise provides with
respect. Motion to adopt.
Second.
Motion to adopt is made by Councilmember Lynch, second by Councilman Everson. Any discussion, please vote. And those approved. Next.
Mr. Chairman, we're now on the regular agenda legislation, resolutions on second reading and final passage. Resolution 12 authorizes the mayor to execute a donation agreement between the City of Shreveport and LRI Ventures, LLC, herein called owner and acting herein through Judith Bruce, manager for the private water and sewer improvements for Elkins Subdivision Unit 3 and related facilities. There is one amendment. The amendment adds a provision which requires a whole harmless agreement in addition to the donation agreement.
Motion.
Second.
Second by Councilman Brown.
Is that on the amendment? Are we on the amendment?
On the amendment. Any discussion? Please vote. Okay, that passes 7-0. Motion to adopt the
motion as amended.
As amended.
As amended.
Second.
Second by Councilman Bradford. Any discussion? Please vote. And that passes 7-0. Mr. Thompson, next.
I believe that there is the request by the administration to remove Resolution 57 concerning Amtrak.
Yes. If I may, I'd like to ask the council members if you would think about allowing us to pull this one so that we could at least get the wording accurately put in to the resolution. The resolution is intended, in my mind, to be able to support the Amtrak service for the Shreveport-Bossier region and not just for the Shreveport,
just my
city of Shreveport. And so if you all will consider that, I'd appreciate it. We were trying to do it together as Shreveport-Bossier. And if you all would consider allowing us to pull that.
Motion by Councilman Bowen, second by Councilman Flurry to withdraw. Any discussion? Please vote. And that passes
7-0. Mr. Chairman, we're now in introduction of resolutions. Resolution 58 authorizes the mayor to execute an intergovernmental agreement between the State of Washington, Department of Labor and Industries, and the City of Shreveport. Resolution 59 authorizes the execution of a cooperative endeavor agreement with Southern Hills Homeowners Association.
Those are the motion to introduce.
Second.
Motion by Flurry. Second, any discussion? Please vote. And that passes.
Mr. Chairman.
Yes.
Just a clarification on Resolution 57. I know we've already voted on it. And I understand the mayor's comments that Shreveport and Bossier are working together to provide Amtrak service, but was the intent of this resolution until that service appears in Shreveport-Bossier just to move the transportation, the van transportation piece of it from the intermodal facility to the nearest station? Or I guess I'm confused about reading the wording here and knowing that there's two different pieces. There's the request for service through Shreveport-Bossier, and then there has long been, I think, a van service that was provided to Shreveport that would take you to maybe Marshall, and it was picking people up down in the casino area. Was the intent of this legislation just to move that to intermodal and a...
No.
Okay, it's just not real clear.
No, actually, that's not the
clear to get it cleaner.
Okay, all right,
just
curious.
It wasn't quite clear. Okay.
Mr. Chairman, we're now under introduction of ordinances. Ordinance 32 amends the 2017 Community Development Special Revenue Fund budget Ordinance 33 amends the 2017 budget for the general fund. Ordinance 34 declares the city's intention to establish permanent and temporary servitudes on certain adjudicated properties for the water and sewer consent decree projects. Ordinance 35 is a zoning matter C-19-17. It rezones property located on the east side of Erie Drive, 414 feet south of King Place, from B2 Neighborhood District to I-1 in Light Industry District.
So moved.
Second.
Councilman Jenkins, and second by Councilman Bowman. Any discussion?
There is discussion.
Okay.
I have a question about Ordinance 32. I understand the million dollars coming in. There's also language that says there will be a 5,000 square foot facility built. So is this $1 million to purchase the land and build that facility? And then there are additional funds that will be required to operate it? I mean, how does this work? Because a million seems like a big number, but there's also some big construction in there.
Okay, we're going to call up Ms. Moore, and she'll be able to answer that, Councilman.
You're absolutely correct. $1 million will not construct the facility. It is a 5,000 square foot facility that will be built on city-owned land. So we won't incur land cost. We have matching funds. We have funds from CDBG of about $600,000 that will augment the $1 million cost to construct the facility. We've already working with an architect who has drawn up the plans, conceptual plans, and he's estimated the cost about $1.4 million. We put an additional $200,000 in for contingency and for the unknown. So the construction costs we're estimating to be about $1.4 million. But we have some other costs that would absorb any cost overruns. Additionally, we're working with philanthropic organizations to help us with a 3-year projection of operating costs. We've already committed some dollars to that as well. We had to make sure that all of this was solidified before we were even awarded the $1 million from HUD.
Is there still a restaurant incubator associated with Cohabitat, or did that go away?
Yeah, they didn't do that. I mean, they started an idea of doing that, but they didn't.
And there's no suitable existing construction in the area.
Now, we looked at several different buildings and actually cost more to rehab and reconfigure those buildings than it did to do new construction. So we did our homework associated with that.
And the intent of the program is to train and assist people who are interested in working in the food service industry or opening their own restaurant or all of the above? Or?
You're absolutely correct. It's an incubate micro businesses in the culinary industry that are not able to grow in that area. And we found, particularly in the inner city neighborhoods, that there are not a lot of micro enterprises that are operating efficiently in those areas for various reasons. The incubator would not only help train them, but give them an opportunity to expand their business outside of the scope of the incubator. We're also looking at food trucks. We're looking at maybe having some pop-up businesses where they can go in and further grow their businesses as well. And it's also to bring in an influx of people into an area that's now desolate and underpopulated and where there are no amenities, and we can grow amenities in that area as well.
And will there also be aspects of the culinary medicine program?
Absolutely. It's probably a four-pronged, multifaceted operation. Not only would it's called an incubator, but it also will be a training facility for people within the community. They can come in and they get trained in healthy living and being able to be trained in the food industry themselves. It will also have a coffee cafe where targeted populations of people can come in and they can grow their business. They can create a business as well. And then it will have a culinary medicine component, and we're really mimicking the program Liberty Kitchen in New Orleans, where the medical industry utilizing the universities will come in and they will help people in the community and also use it as a training vehicle for themselves. And so we'll work with all the universities and we'll have an influx of people coming into a community where they never came before. And it'll be a diverse group of people. And those people we're hoping that will buy food or invest right there at the facility.
And are people in our community asking for such training?
Absolutely. Absolutely. We had a lot of interest in the culinary industry. Even when we were very fortunate in the small business loan program, most of our applicants were in the culinary industry, and they failed. And so we're trying to keep them from failing.
It does seem like that's a very high risk business.
It is.
And in the last few months, mm-hmm. we've certainly seen a lot of chain restaurants fail or close for whatever reason in Shreveport. So I'm a little cautious if the intention is going to be carried out to fruition and actually create successful business future. But I appreciate all the information.
You're more than welcome.
And before she sit down, I wanted to share this with Councilman Bowman. Yesterday, during your absence, Ms. Moore gave the council members, I think, just kind of a background. This particular project is one that was selected by HUD under the Choice Grant application. When I asked them to apply for it, we got the $1 million. We had to use the money based on what the application was about from the planning, about 4 years ago. And there were three top projects that were included in that application. And HUD chose this project out of all the others. And of course, it was a very high-level, competitive-type grant. But because we had all the details and the data to drive what we're trying to do with it, it was approved, and we got the $1 million last year. And so that's how we got to this place, and I kind of want you to know that.
I look forward to hearing the success stories.
So do I.
And if I would add, we were the only city in the United States of America that received this grant.
Only city in the U.S. From HUD. But I truly believe that with the energy and the planning that we put forth on this one, we will see some success with people who have not been able to succeed in the business world. So we're going to give it all that we can to ensure that this is a good program for the citizens and for those who really want that hand up so that they can help themselves.
And if I can add again, Southern is incorporating their culinary training program to this. It's going to be actually housed at the incubator.
And I'll just add a little bit more. I mean, this is in my district, and I've had the privilege of probably knowing a little bit more about the program than some people have. Though I'm looking forward to an update, I think that's scheduled later this week, so I can learn a little bit more. But you know, some of these aspects of this culinary medicine program are really fascinating. I mean, you know, I think we've heard the little buzzwords and you hear the jargon that comes up from time to time about food deserts and, you know, things like that. And this is, I mean, that, you know, I don't mean to make light of it by saying it. It's just sometimes we hear these political terminologies, and to make it real, I mean, you have to think this is a neighborhood that is home to a lot of people and used to be home to a lot more people, that the point of Choice Neighborhoods is to create a community that is self-sustaining, that will last, that is able to stand up on its own. And part of doing that is having access to healthy, healthy food and having entrepreneurs that know how to follow a business model that serves their community. You know, there is a community that is underserved in our inner city because they have to drive across the city to get to restaurants, diners, delis, those kind of things. Whereas many of us, you know, who live in parts of the city that don't suffer from as much disinvestment, can go to a cafe down the street or a small mom and pop type deli, and those things have, you know, are a lot there's a lot more threats to those in an inner city neighborhood, and that's, you know, so this is something that not only has some short-term benefits, but also is designed for some long-term benefits for the neighborhood, and that's one of the reasons that HUD chose it, and that's one of the type of projects that this grant is meant to implement. It's sort of an amenity or a piece that will complement the housing development that should follow.
Okay.
I'm sorry. One moment, Councilwoman Lynch.
Yes. What is culinary medicine?
Oh, that, do you have an answer?
Yes.
It's cool.
It's a form of training and incorporating healthy eating styles into the life of people that would not otherwise have this. And in New Orleans and Liberty Kitchen, which Councilman Corbin has been extremely successful, has been so successful that it has been catalytic in bringing in other investments into the community. There's a Whole Foods now right next door because of their investment into Liberty Kitchen. But to further answer your question, it's a style of creating healthy foods through culinary medicine. And when they say medicine, it's healthy. It's creating a healthy lifestyle.
And what they're doing, Stephanie, is this is not...
You're not in.
No.
Well, if I could add to that, it's not just, you know, we all kind of hear the typical advice of, you know, we need to eat less sugar, eat more vegetables, those kind of things that we know to be true. But this culinary medicine actually takes it a little step further in ways that they incorporate... in New Orleans, they incorporate medical students as well, because a lot of times, by the time people show up at their doctor, they're getting diagnosed with conditions and being prescribed medicine when there is documented, accountable, numbers that they can say, if you eat these foods instead of these foods, your risk for dying decreases by this percentage. You know, I mean, it's very specific, and it's not just about let's live healthier lifestyles. It's specific. I mean, it says, look, if you're eating these things, that shortens your life expectancy by this. You can eat these three things this week and add them to your diet this many times a month, and it will increase your life expectancy by this many years. You know, so it's a well thought out system. The guy that presented it was brought in, the guy that developed it, and it's been used throughout the country. But he came in as a speaker to the Martin Luther King Healthcare Centers about 2 years ago. And it was very impressive. So, I mean, it really is a program. Again, it's a pilot level. It's one aspect of a larger vision, you know. But if it has the kind of success it had in New Orleans, it'll be not just business success, but also a life expectancy success for a neighborhood that has a lot of seniors. So, I mean, and children. So.
Yeah, why are you looking at me when you're saying that?
And they do it in conjunction.
Light on the season.
And they do it in conjunction with Tulane Medical School as well, and then they have LSU and other schools incorporated into it as well. It's grown to that point. It's been so successful that they're now franchising it throughout the country.
Okay, so we want to get a... And it's so cute, Jeff, when you get excited about stuff. It really is.
Hey, one of the disadvantages of being a young man is I hope you're not taking me less seriously.
Oh, I take young being real seriously.
That's a whole different conversation.
Culinary medicine. I think I've been listening to Bad and Bougie too much. Mm-hmm. But so I was a little thrown off by what that meant. So we won't get a Silver Moon barbecue out of this. This is not what this is. This is healthy eating.
No Harlem House, y'all.
Okay. Healthy eating.
Right.
Okay, so it's kind of like going from using the word housekeeper to environmental engineer. It's just a new phrase, culinary medicine for something.
Yeah, it was kind of coined by Tulane University.
Okay. Well, thank you, and congratulations.
Oh, thank you.
You said
you're more than
welcome. City?
Pardon?
The only city that got this money?
Yeah, the only city that had a planning grant that received this $1 million, yes.
Wow. Congratulations.
Congratulations to you, Mayor.
Thank you.
Thank you,
Mayor.
Okay.
Mr. Chairman, we're now under ordinances.
We have to vote on this. We need to vote from Mr. Leave
Bowman and Mr. And that passes.
And y'all thought B wasn't paying attention.
Yeah. Well, she shook me up on that cold there.
Ordinances on second reading. Ordinance 30 amends the 2017 capital improvements budget.
So moved, Mr. Chairman.
Second. Motion by Councilman Rafferty, second by Councilman. Any discussion? Would you please vote?
Councilman
Bradford told me to stop cutting
that.
And
6-1 check
passes.
Ordinance 31 amends the 2017 budget funding contractual services provided by Sportran.
So moved.
Second. So moved by Councilwoman Lynch, second by Councilman Bowman. Any discussion? Please vote. And
then, Mr. Chairman, those are all of the items on the regular agenda. I'm not aware of any item on the tabled agenda to come off of the table at this time.
All right, we move on down to reports. Officers, boards, and committees. Are there any reports to bring today?
No, I will be trying to get a meeting together for public safety. So okay. I'll deal with Jack and the debate.
All right, Ms. Thompson, the clerk report.
I have no additional report today, Mr. Chairman.
Okay. And we need to go ahead and vote on this MPC. That's next week.
That's next.
I mean next week. Okay. Any additional communications?
I have one. It's at the
mayor.
Okay.
Mayor,
do you have anything? No, Father. Thank you.
Madam Mayor. Okay. And council members?
Mr. Chairman, I have one. This morning we had a health fair, and Ms. Tarver, Jean Tarver, came and made a presentation regarding her Walk for Humanity that will be held on April the 8th at it was sort of assembling at 8 in front of the Bonwell. And she asked that I would exhort those who are present here to come. We have a sponsor for some walkers. And she also wanted me to relay that if any council members and their wives or spouses would like to participate in the walk, that you give her a call at 773-7613. And you would be the recipient of a complimentary registration and T-shirt if you agree to walk. So any council members or council staff that want to walk, can do that.
1673.
Yeah, no six. I'm sorry, 773-7613.
Don't yes. Call 46. Get willing out.
So that's gonna be a courtesy that's gonna be for someone. And I know that's the Great American Cleanup Day. You can walk and then make it over to your site to help clean up. But I just want to express that and she spoke here about two or three council members ago and made that a plea on how important this walk is. It's really one of her major fundraisers as it relates to the revenue that's generated from this walk. But she wants a big crowd to be there, so that's why this has been afforded to a sponsor. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Any other communication, Council?
Oh, let me mention that again. Nature and Derek is here. They have some banana wave product they want to share with whoever's here, is that right? I know. Okay, so whoever, before you leave, just stop by their little area over here and just try that. If you try it, you're going to like it. You're going to want to buy something. You go over Cattle Market on Hearn and get something. It's still there, right? Okay.
Okay. Any additional? Nobody else? Okay. Further comments?
Ms. Ann's former. Oh, let's see.
Hi, I'm Ann Fumarola from Shreveport, 820 Clyde Fant. And I wanted to come down. 4 months ago, we opened the new museum, Pop Museum, to kind of let you know how it's doing. And if you haven't come by, come on by. We projected to see about 250,000 people in the first year, and we are well ahead of projection. So that's a really, really good news. We did, when I did the budgeting, we took a little off for the science side, and we're pretty much on that too. So it has been really doing really, really well for us. So thank you for all your support. I also wanted to come down here and one time not be here asking something, but really saying thank you. And while you own our building, we understand that we do appreciate what you do for us. It's not expected, it is appreciated. So thank you very, very much. If you're coming down to Shreveport, we're going to have Dak Prescott Days. So if you like Dak Prescott, he will be at Shreveport doing the science of football. So we'll let you know that. We also have Rod Demery coming in to do the science of forensic science for us. And if you don't know this, we'll be bringing the drag boat races are coming back, and Shreveport will be supporting them on the river right across the street. So lots of things going down with us. We are trying to work with the aquarium to get a fish movie to open for their opening movie. We'll have IMAX stuff going on with the aquarium and everything. But I really wanted to one stop by and that be my time in August saying, oh, please support us, but be down here one time looking at you just saying thank you. So thank you.
What day is Dak Prescott Day?
Well, it's in June, but I forgot one thing really important. You know my building falls apart, which is that's how it is. Shelley Regal and her department is amazing, as is the mayor, helping keep Shreveport alive. And we are, as you know, it's an older building, and we really are on duct tape a lot of times. We've not had a fire panel for almost 2 months. The parts came in today. I have been in the building doing the 3 a.m. to 6 noon shift a lot because we have to have a fire watcher there all the time at the building. And they have been wonderful to work with, and thank you, thank you, thank you to SPAR. They are just great. Thank you.
I love it when Shelley sings that song, If I Had a Hammer.
Kenneth Krell? State your name and address. You have 3 minutes, please.
Thank you. Kenneth Krell, 157 Archer Avenue, Shreveport, 71105. At this point, last Thursday, the commission chose not to adopt the UDC, so we'll have to kick that can a little farther down the road. I've just had a couple other minor comments. Some I've made before, some I'll make again. Still looking for ways to save money, and I still see no reason why the water bills have to be read every month. I find several cities that do it bi-monthly or quarterly. I don't know why, unless we just insist on paying meter readers monthly. And a little comparison with the police between two crimes of a sort, a parking ticket and an expired state tag. And right outside when I fed the meter and put in my last 35 cents, at meter 511, a white Ford, and if you're in here, your license plate is XRY669, had a February 17 expiration on the state tag. That person is more likely to get a ticket for being over the white line by 2 inches than an expired meter, expired state tag, even though the safety to the public is greater from an expired tag because of a windshield, tail light, whatever. But boy, don't let them be 2 inches over that white line front or back. The overzealousness of the meter maids is maybe admirable to an extent, but the underzealousness of the officers in writing tickets to expired state tags is overwhelming. And at Walmart today, of the 50 I checked, 8 were expired, 16%, and 4 more were March of 17, about to expire in 3 days. We really should do something about that because it's an unsafe situation. Couple other monetary things real quick. I've asked this for 4 years, nothing. EMS still $35 a year. If you're never going to raise it, just say that it's permanent. It's been that way for a long time. And finally, the Akron Avenue paving. Oliver, I hope it gets started soon. In January, I was told 2 weeks. In February, I was told 2 weeks. In March, I was told 2 weeks. It's been 2 months. You can't hold a contractor forever to his bid price. He's got a right to get turning dirt. If you prices go up, and his bid was made in good faith, and it's been over 4 months since we bid that project, maybe they started today. When I went by there yesterday, I didn't see anything. So
I'm being told it's imminent.
Oh, well, imminent sounds closer than 2 weeks.
I mean like a month.
I'm just
look up imminent. I don't know. Imminent in government terms, I mean, Uri and Kings was imminent in 97.
Okay, I can.
And all of a sudden, 18 years later, it was bid. So I was told by DOTD in August of 97, Uri and Kings was imminent.
We're not going to get a new governor in the next to 3 weeks, nor a new city.
With DOTD, imminent can be 18 years. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Councilwoman Lynch?
Yes. I just wanted to just let the police department know when we were out Saturday, I got quite a few complaints about speeding still on West Canal. Chief Crump? I just want to make sure before I forget. When we were out Saturday doing the neighborhood cleanup, I got quite a few complaints still about speeding on West Canal. We've done the trap, you know, put the little, speed I guess, bumps. Camera up, because, you know, the kid had gotten killed there right by Bryant Temple in that area. I think I got a complaint somewhere, like right in there. But anyway, the entire street. 70th on back. They said they're still coming through that really fast. I asked what time of day. He said all day, which we were out there for 4 hours, 4 or 5 hours. I didn't really see it all day, but I'm just reporting what was reported to me. So, so whatever we can do. And then the stop sign, the four-way stop by the school, I think they reported that people are still rolling that stop sign or just running it all together.
Okay.
Thank you.
Yes, ma'am. We have someone to get to
that. I have Sammy Mears. State your name and address, and you have 3 minutes to
Sammy Mears, 1901 Centenary Boulevard, Shreveport, Louisiana, 71101. On March 29th and April 5th, this Wednesday and next week, will be the very last 2 dates of Wednesday Lent soup, dessert, ice water, and coffee at the Holy Cross Episcopal Church at 11 a.m. for $4. Hope somebody can come out and join that. And I want to also encourage anyone who hasn't been able to come out yet, please mark it on your calendar and please come. Just recently, Jeff Everson and myself, being in the Sunday's paper, we were at the showing the food, and the food was really yummy because we were in the Sunday paper, and I have evidence to prove that.
We sure were. I met Sammy.
I've been waiting to bring this, and that's what I was trying to show everyone earlier. And for those who got to see it up close, they did. Art Thompson was the first one that I made sure who would see this. Also, the fact is that the 3 other people, they were there in the paper as well. So you need to give yourself a little time from work to come on one of these 2 last dates, March 29th or April 5th for $4 at 11 a.m. And also on Saturday, April the 8th, I'm going to be at the Noble Methodist Church for the Easter celebration meal. They have that every year at 11 a.m. So if you do have time with something else, that's understandable. If you can break away and come to that, I would encourage you to do that too. Because they have a good barbecue chicken with some good other foods and dessert and lemonade. I want to pass that along. But I'm going to try to find somebody to help me get this laminated, because this needs a laminating at once. I'm going to tell you right now, I'm not going to let this slip away. And I'm going to call a couple of people and see if they can make a little time.
Leave it with me. I have it laminated, and I'll bring it to you tomorrow if you're going to let my picture.
I'm going to be at the Holy Cross Episcopal Church at 11.
I'm saying I'll bring it to you. Can we get our picture taken with you if we come?
Who?
I mean, but I'll laminate it for you. Just leave it behind, okay?
You mean you want me to give it to you now?
That's what he means. You got it.
Give it to one of the clerks, and I get it from them.
I'll give it to Art.
Yeah, he trusts Art. You don't want to give it to him.
You were the first one to see it, so you get to give it to him.
I have been laminated.
Sam, I wouldn't trust the politician either. I don't blame you, baby.
And I wouldn't trust you anymore. I wouldn't trust you any more than I would a bouncer or a piece of fresh bacon.
I know it.
There are no more public comments. I did see Dr. Jerome Cox out in the audience, and I didn't know if Dr. Cox had something he wanted to say or not. He's new on the Property Standards Board, and I just wanted to recognize him.
Mayor, I'll say hello. My name is Jerome Cox.
God, I hated I would be the last one, so just people ready to go. But I wanted to say, Mayor, thank you for allowing me and the councilman to serve as the chairman of Property Standards. I'm not sure how that happened. I had been on that board for a while, and I came 45 minutes late to make sure I didn't get to serve as the chairman. But we're excited. We have a lot of things that we're trying to reconcile for the city, and we're really getting out there trying to do our best to make sure that the citizens realize we want to see a sweeter, cleaner, and a better Shreveport. So I want to thank you all. Also, finally, we started a different business 18 months ago. I'm proud to say we've been able to employ nearly 300 employees here in this city. So thank you.
Councilman Bradford.
Yeah, before you dismiss him. Mayor, yes. A deputy, adjacent to Anthony's steakhouse on Valley View, there's a water leak. It's spreading out pretty well, so help somebody look at that.
I'll ask Ms. Phillips.
I think it's 2900 block of Valley View.
2900
block. Yeah, right off of Mansfield Road.
Okay. Ms. Featherston will get on that.
All right, thank you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
Councilman Ellis. I was just going to ask real quickly, I just got another email about this, and I know I've asked it multiple times, but are we going to get an update on the Lake Street closing?
The Lake Street closing.
Yeah, that's a...
And Mr. Westerman would be the one to do that. He's not in here right now.
No, he is. He just walked in.
Come on up. And I can tell you, it hasn't been 3 or 4 months. We talked about this. Probably about 6 weeks ago that we talked to this guy. So let's get that timeline straight. It wasn't 4 months, but we have. Can you give us an update?
Yes, ma'am. I spoke with the UPR Railroad here just recently last week. They're in the process of designing the crossing for the four-way gate system. I look to have that done, or they're telling me they should have something done on it in about a month to get us an estimate in cost of construction, so that we can move forward with it.
Okay, I just want to make this clear, like, that, you know, when we closed this, and this was before Mayor Tyler took office, but, you know, the legislation said that we would get a quarterly update. This is maybe the first update that we've had. That was in late 2014. And we said that we were going to close it for 2 years. That 2 year mark has elapsed, and the people are furious that they've heard nothing, and they keep asking, and I know I've been asking, and, you know, hearing we're just starting to look at design is a pretty unsatisfactory answer to them. You know, they were expecting this to be completed and open by now, and so we may need some more details to be able to communicate what's been going on, because
let me just ask.
Impacted a number of businesses, and they've been closed thinking, oh, we'll hold on a little longer because it's going to reopen soon.
Let me ask what has been the situation, Mr. Everson. Here again, this legislation was passed before I came aboard. Now, on my watch, we've been pushing for projects to be done, and we've done many, even though we don't always hear thank you, but we've done many. So on this one, I'm not sure what the holdup is, so we will get back with you. Mr. Westerman will certainly get an update, provide that to you and the public, and let me find out what's going on
yes, ma'am.
With it. I don't know why it's not done, and I'm not going to sit here and try to make an excuse.
Sure, I appreciate that. And I certainly, I respect our, you know, that working with railroads, I mean, I can understand there's probably got to be layers of bureaucracy there, you know. I mean, I can understand that. But I just need to know so I can help communicate that.
And we'll communicate it, Mr. Efferson. I'll make sure that happens within the next week. Yes.
Can I ask something, though, that is a little history here? Because I'm not sure I quite remember the whole history.
Okay.
So when we did this piece of legislation, the premise was 2-year closing, right?
Originally, the request was for 3 years. It was at council's urgency that we tried to restrict it to 2 years.
Okay. So that was one of the things I was getting a little confused about. The second part is the cost. Who bears the cost of, I had some $1 million or something in my mind at one point. Am I off base on that number?
The cost of construction was given to us originally at about $600,000 to $700,000. And in accordance with the agreement that we signed with the local business owner, the Holiday Inn business owner, they're to pay for 50% of the cost of construction up to $400,000 for the purpose of putting this system in.
Okay, and then the other 50% is being formed by the city.
The city will pay for a portion of it. We've asked the state to also pay for a portion.
Okay, and that's the other part. I was going to ask, wasn't the state somehow at least approached about this?
Yes, sir, that is correct.
Okay, and the, because I, separate from him, I didn't get the most recent email, but I got a slew of them in the last week, so maybe they're, whatever, the anti or the Lake Street Urgers are out there right this moment, because I'm getting my emails right now, and I'm a little having a little trouble remembering it. So the UDR, is that what
it is? Union Pacific Railroad Company.
So Union Pacific Railroad is going to provide the engineering design of the project.
They're required to, sir.
They're required to by state law?
By the requirements of the union that deals with the Union Pacific Railroad Company.